What's good, everybody?
What's good?
All right, so I'm about to be controversial for how many minutes, Gordon? 30 minutes. All right, that's enough to be very controversial. Please feel free to tweet at Rosa Clemente. My Instagram is Black Puerto Rican PhD or Black Puerto Rican PhD. And I'm on Facebook, but none of you are, so most young people aren't on Facebook anymore. Okay, it was good. You know, does anybody from the back want to move? Everybody's good. It's so many, this is a big space, right? So I'm going to talk for 40 minutes. Just give me the heads up when I have 5 minutes left. And then I'm open to Q&A. First and foremost, thank you for having me be your inaugural speaker for your Hispanic Heritage Month. Is this the first kind of like time celebrating Hispanic Heritage Month in a very institutional sense? So thank you for me being the first one. May my words tonight not have you have another Latina like me. I don't think you will, but you know. I'm always honored to be able to speak because many people and many of our ancestors have spoken truth to power and actually been killed because of it. I do not put myself in any of those categories. I do not put myself in the category of a Harriet Tubman or a Malcolm X or an Albizu Campos, Lolita LeBron, Mumia Abu-Jamal, people who literally sacrificed their entire lives for the freedom of our people. But I understand that we also live in a time where truth is not respected. So I'm always honored, and I thank everybody who helped put this together, particularly Gloria and Tiffany, who worked really, really hard to bring this program and to bring me on campus, and the sister I just met earlier, Sylvia, who was the one that told Gloria, you might want to bring her, and as well as Angela Blue, and any of the students and faculty and staff that have had me here. It was really an honor to be in your class with Dean Walker, to see some folks I know from the East Coast. Is my homie from Queens up in here? No? Antonio, where's your homie? What's up? See, that's what's wrong with New York people. We're always late. Always late. And as well as the faculty development, it was really good to be able to be with the faculty that showed up that have a high interest in making sure that you are not just getting a degree, but that you're getting an intellectual, rigorous education. So with that said, James Baldwin said, to be a Negro in this country and to be relatively conscious is to be enraged almost all the time. Bell Hooks says, make your home site a place of resistance. Dr. John Henry Clark, one of the greatest African historians we will ever know. Powerful people cannot afford to educate the people they oppress, because once you are truly educated, you will not ask for power, you will take it. Assata Shakur, my hero, heroine. People get used to anything. The less you think about your oppression, the more your tolerance for it grows. After a while, people think oppression is the normal state of things, right? You know, to speak, I was supposed to speak about being a Black Puerto Rican and Afro-Latino identity, and I feel like I spoke about that a lot. And I also, today, I also feel that in terms of what some people call identity politics, it could be very subjective. It depends on the time that we're in. And also, I'm not gonna really go into why I'm a Black Puerto Rican a little bit. Because I think we're in a time where white supremacy doesn't care if I'm Puerto Rican or you're from Winston-Salem or from Charlotte or Greensboro. The system that we're living under, white supremacy, patriarchy, and capitalism, is not a system of humanity. And it's really trying to figure out what they're going to do with all these people of color. Because see, we don't need to work their fields anymore or their factories. And as we become the majority collectively of people of African descent, like we are globally in the rest of the world, this system does not know what to do with us. What it will do is create a buffer class of us, that we so separate ourselves from the Crips and the Blood and the gangbanger and the drug dealer and all these things that the system says those brothers and sisters trying to live and eat are doing. I just got off the phone with my husband. His name is Justice. My husband's formerly incarcerated. Let me tell you the situation we are in now that I bet you is not different from any, if not at least half of you in this room right now. And Brother Coach just wrote another amazing art, another amazing investigative piece. Do you guys know who Ta-Nehisi Coates is? Because if you don't, you need to immediately know who he is. I don't agree with all of his politics, but the journalism that he's been doing in the last 2 years around reparations, and now this article he just wrote on not mass incarceration of an individual, but mass incarceration of families, is amazing. So I was like, just babe, I gotta tell folks like the situation we're in. He's like, all right, it's not like you need it. He's like, why are you calling me? I'm like, well, it's your fam. So, you know, I could talk about my family. Yours is the current condition we're in. My husband, Justice, is formerly incarcerated. He's been out for 21 years. When he got out, he got parole for life. Imagine parole for life. I met him and I was like, what do you mean you're on parole? I'm an organizer. I never heard of this. This is madness. It took us 2 years to petition the courts to get him off parole for life. I said, how did you stay out of trouble for 13 years? Any one situation could have got you violated. Any one probation officer could have taken the rest of your life. Our stepson is incarcerated. His brother is facing a huge charge that could give him life. And his best friend is in the worst facility in New York State where every day they're beating inmates and denying people their diabetic medication. One person in my life, his son, his best friend, and his brother. You have to understand the ripple effects of that into an entire community. And then what does it mean when we have to send money and we have to drive 9 hours and we have to go through this and humiliation just to get in to see them and make sure they're okay? What does it mean when we don't have money for a lawyer and has to be a public defender? See, this is the reality of the majority of African American and Latino, Latina lives, Native Indigenous people's lives in this country. There is no one in this room that hasn't suffered the effects of mass incarceration. You might not be locked up, but someone you know, someone in your family, or someone in your future will be locked up. One of your kids you have that does everything right will be locked up. We have enough research that talks about a school-to-prison pipeline. Now we have new research that talks about sexual abuse to the prison pipeline that focuses on directly on women in prison, right? Women are the majority group growing in the prison population. This new report talks about the sexual abuse to prison pipeline. By the time African-American women and Latino women are 18, 44% have reported that they've been sexually abused, reported. What about all the women that didn't? What kind of spiral? See, this like mass incarceration is such a critical piece to talk about in our communities because that's the ultimate form of social control right now. They're testing other forms of social control in cities like Ferguson and Baltimore by using militarized police to stop us from protesting. Okay? It's important that we understand this as people in higher education. I've been in higher education since 1990 when I became an undergrad. It is 2015 and in a year and a so I'll have my dissertation. 27 years I spent also going around this country, being an organizer, learning, being mentored, being a professor, all of this. And the material conditions of our people have gotten worse. And I won't go down statistics, but let's be very clear, we are living in a world of the 1% and the 99% on a real economic basis. And then within that economic basis, the few of us that do attain these degrees, every study has shown that we'll never make more money than a white man who dropped out of high school. This is all statistical facts. And people have problems with this. It's cognitive dissonance. Who's a psychologist? Right? Like, they're like, it's happening, but it won't happen to me. It's kind of like Dr. Dre. No, it's like Ice Cube saying, and this is Ice Cube words, so please. Well, if you ain't a bitch and a hoe, then me calling you a bitch and a hoe ain't gonna matter. Dude, you're like 45, and you're still saying that. Really? Okay. Cognitive dissonance. And with these spaces of privileges and these opportunities that we've been given, if we waste it, we've done a disservice to our collective history of struggle and resistance. As well, we would betray the legacy of every ancestor and our fallen sisters and brothers all around this country. I don't want any more black, brown, women, men becoming hashtags to tweet as we await 28 hours or less for the next death at the hands of the state. I think one of the questions we have to ask ourselves internally is, what is my sacrifice? Each generation out of relative obscurity must discover its mission, fulfill it, or betray it. That's Frantz Fanon. If you don't know who he is, go Google and read his first book, The Wretched of the Earth, or Black Skin, White Mask. It will literally change your life. Because see, where we're at right now is we also need to be at a process of constant decolonization. I tell people, we have an addiction. Like, I feel like Black and Latinos have an addiction to the Democratic Party. How are we gonna kill that addiction, or the Democratic Party? How are we gonna kill that addiction? This is saying, how are we gonna decolonize on a daily basis? And it's hard. Because this society just wants you to think that if you make money and have a nice house and have visibility, maybe put out a hit record, a hit book, you're gonna be all right. And the thing is, you should be doing those things because those are personal goals. But you can't ever get it twisted and think you're gonna be all right. The only way we'll be all right is when we upend this whole entire system. We may be in that process now. I don't think we're at that process right now. I think we may be moving towards that, where hopefully my daughter will be engaged in this true revolutionary struggle. But right now, all we're trying to do is stem the tide so one of us doesn't get killed when we walk out of here tomorrow. Because it's a statistics show. That's what's happening with state violence. And then the intra violence, right? So I grew up in the South Bronx. Right, the home of hip hop. And in 2008, along with Cynthia McKinney, former Democratic Congresswoman from Atlanta, Georgia, Cynthia McKinney, we became the first woman of color ticket in American presidential politics. We were nominated by the Green Party. This was in 2008. So if they had a real debate, I would have debated Sarah Palin and smashed her. And Cynthia would not beat Obama, but we definitely would have gotten the 5% that we needed to be a national party. I had knew Cynthia for a long time as a congresswoman. In fact, it was the last time I was probably at the Congressional Black Caucus here meetings in September in DC. High, you know, elite black petty bourgeois politicians and rich people, but still a good space to go talk about issues if you want to deal with electoral politics. And Cynthia had brought us in after she did a hearing on political prisoners in the United States in the counterintelligence program. And we just hit it off, and I had kept in contact with her, and then she got voted out. She got primaried out. The Congressional Black Caucus, they got a black woman to run as a Republican because they wanted Cynthia out as a Democrat. Because Cynthia grilled Donald Rumsfeld for 2 days in a congressional hearing about the war in Iraq. And the blowback to Cynthia was so bad, her own people, congressional CBC, the high, Elijah Cummings, Maxine Waters, all of them, got somebody to run as a Republican in Atlanta so Cynthia wouldn't even win the primary. She got voted out of office. She joined the Green Party. She called me. I was living right here. I was in North Carolina. I was living in Charlotte. And we went in one of our transitions, and I was just broke. And she called me. I was like, sure, I need a job. I'll run for vice president. And 6 days later, I was in Chicago, Illinois, and we got the nomination. And I don't tell that story flippantly. I just tell it as it's part of who I was. Like, of course I'm going to run against the Democrats. Like, I already know this is a farce. I know that once I declare I'm running with Cynthia against the potential first black president in America, the hate is coming. Like, you know, I know it's coming. I didn't know it would come from the community I have been working with a decade, the kind of hip-hop generation political community where we have been putting out agendas, and where I literally took the agenda of the hip-hop political community and put it in my nomination speech and made the Green Party commit to those things. And then I realized the technology and theater of electoral politics, right? And I'm here living in North Carolina, trying to get people to vote for me in North Carolina. First, they're like, are you even black? Like, I don't understand who you are. And you're calling yourself a black Puerto Rican. Like, what is that? Are you Mexican? Like, that's good. And that's your husband. That's your daughter. Like, questioning. And it was something that I hadn't really, you know, who thinks about running for vice president. But I said, we won 34 ballots. We were here in North Carolina as write-ins, so when I went to vote in Charlotte, I had to like write my name, but the Green Party was on the ballot, and we got to write it in. You know, and we got about 500,000 votes, which is absolutely, I don't think it's even a 0.1 percentage of the total thing, but we also only ran a campaign that was like $300,000 compared to President Obama and John McCain's total of $750 million. The Green Party is a third party. We take no corporate money. So when I did run, and that was again in 2008, I didn't understand what the ramifications of that would be, as well as the good things that would come out of it. I was just in it. I was going around the country talking about the issues I love, talking about black and brown people, talking about hip hop, political prisoners, free Puerto Rico, you know, and in front of many type of different crowds. But what I realized then when I was running was that it was the people from the hood, like the laundromat, the you know, Medicaid office, because that's where I was going. And what I did notice was that young college students weren't really feeling us. But that's because President Obama and his team had an excellent social media campaign, and you can't fight that type of money. This current campaign, you know how much this current campaign is going to cost to run? They're estimating $1.4 billion. So that was in 08. And I had this much hope in electoral politics. And it's 2016, I have no hope in electoral politics. Well, okay, 2%. Because I still will vote for president, whoever ends up being the Green Party nominee. So I tell you that story as something that some people may say is a sacrifice, but I don't view it as a sacrifice. I view it as that's what we're supposed to do. I'm not here, I didn't get all these degrees and have all this knowledge to then act like I don't know what's happening around me, or to not be a voice, you know? And I think about either our ancestors or people who are currently political prisoners in this country, like Amumu Abdul-Jabbar, Jalil Muntakim, Leonard Peltier, Oscar Lopez Rivera, the Move 9, now Move 8, since Brother John Africa passed away in prison last year. And I'm like, that's sacrificing, right? And the only way I even got to that point, and I spoke about this earlier with the students in the first session was of my experience in college, going to college, meeting my professor, being mentored, taking Black studies, taking Puerto Rican studies. I came in thinking I knew what it was, everything to be Boricua. I didn't know anything about myself, and I grew up in New York as a Puerto Rican. I didn't know anything about my history. I didn't know that we were a colony under the rule of the United States of America. I didn't know we had been invaded and that we fought back. I didn't know that people literally went to the Congress in 1954 as Puerto Rican independence and opened fire on the Congress floor of the United States and tried to kill the president as a move towards using revolutionary violence as independence. I didn't know any of this. I didn't know I came from a people who produced someone like the Don Pedro Albizu Campos or Lolita LeBron or Dilcia Pagan, Oscar Lopez Rivera, and so many more people. And that moment came for me full circle in 2003, where after 67 years of an underground and an above ground struggle in the United States, the Navy finally left part of Puerto Rico called Vieques. They were there for 67 years. Vieques was used to be what was the Northern Command of the US military. So in order to get to the rest of the world, you had to go through that part of the Caribbean. And when Puerto Rico was taken as a colony, they used that as a base. But they also did a lot of experimentations on that island with radiation. And to this day, there's over half the island has radiation. And at one point, half of the people who lived in Vieques had some form of cancer on the specific island of Vieques. I was there reporting that day for a news site, a radio station. I didn't know that I came from people that had been tortured and in prison, assassinated, sterilized, experimented on. For 20 years, Johnson & Johnson paid the US government to basically go to what is known as the Jibara women in Puerto Rico, that the Black Puerto Rican women, the poor women, more in the hills, and they tested their first methods of birth control on the women. But they essentially, for 15 years, sterilized and would sterilize one third of the island, one third of the women, by putting IUDs in them and using like the Catholic religion, like, well, you don't want to keep having babies, right? So just put this in and you won't have babies. But they were experimenting on them, so like women would just die, or like basically their insides would explode. This happened where, again, one third of the women on the island were sterilized, and then this doctor actually then gets sent to the Bronx, Lincoln Hospital in New York, and sterilized 20,000 more African American and Latino women without their knowledge. I didn't know any of this. I grew up in New York in the Bronx where all this was happening. I didn't know nothing. My parents knew, but they were too afraid to tell me what was happening. Because they were on that, just keep your head down, work hard, we'll be good. Just don't say anything. Don't rock the boat, all that. That's the kind of mentality. Don't speak Spanish. Don't tell people this. Don't really do this. Don't do that. Right? They had us so scared about being a Boricua and what that actually meant. And all of this work, whether I came to who I was and found myself essentially at the State University of Albany to Cornell University, where I really honed my writing skills and became, I think, a true intellectual within the tutelage of Dr. Turner and being in Africana Studies, and finally being able to be in the Black Studies field and be who I was as a Black Puerto Rican woman was so incredible. And all of this, you know, comes through, for me, a higher education experience. So I understand what higher education can do. I understand that the skills it can bring. But I also understand that higher education looks very different than it looked 20 years ago. And that a lot of higher education, unfortunately, has been so corporatized and so monetized that is often not about the students anymore. I honestly don't think that's the case here at Winston-Salem. Like, first, I'm not a religious person, but I go off energy. And the energy I've been feeling is good compared to some other spaces I was in. I was in Duke 2 weeks ago, and the energy was completely different. And they probably have, what, 10 times the resources that you all have, if not more, than Duke. They're like, what, number 7 in endowments in the whole college system. And I realized that idea of oppression and what Audre Lorde talked about, right? The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. But yo, while we're up in here, let's get as many tools as possible, because the war against us, we need every tool right now. We need every tactic in the book. We need journalists, professors, teachers, those that are going to drop out, movement lawyers. We need every tactic in the book. Because this system right now is coming so hard at us. Harder than even 3 years ago. Many of you in this room are coming into a time, right? Especially, who's first years here? Any first years? From first years? Okay, that's good. Second years? Okay. So, right, you're arriving at a time when the Black Lives Matter movement, the historical era that will be, or it's already the Black Lives Matter era, or the Ferguson historical era, you're coming at a time where 65% of African American and Latino children live in poverty. You're arriving at a time when student debt is $1 trillion, if not, I think it's now $1.4 trillion, where people are fighting for a $15 minimum wage, which in most cities is not a livable wage, where most people spend more than half their money on rent, where many of us will never be able to own a house, start a business. You arrive at a time where every 28 hours, which I referenced before, this comes out of the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement report that was researched and put together by this woman called Arlene Eisen, but published by the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement. I worked on the getting that report out. And some of you may have seen it if you've been involved in BLM or any kind of political space. Every 28 hours, it cites where every 28 hours an African-American man, woman, or child is killed by the police. Now, we did this report in 2011, kind of before the historical moment we're in around state violence even occurred. We're updating it to add Latinos and Latinas and indigenous folks, and that number is going to drop to every 16 hours, if not lower, in this country. It just being killed by the police, okay? That's what we call state violence, right? You're also arriving at a time where transgender women of color's life expectancy is just 35 years old. You're arriving at a time when everyday families, mostly Latina families, are rounded up, detained, and deported more than ever before, and this is under a Democratic president. President Barack Obama has deported more people than George Bush did. Most of those deported, 90%, are Latino, Latina, even though Latinos and Latinas account for 40% of the undocumented population. You arrive at a time when your public education school system was effectively destroyed, and I feel very bad for any of you that went through a public education. And I say this as a former New York City public school teacher who quit once I was like, oh, they're just trying to lock up our kids. Like, I'm good. Like, I'm not walking into a school where I gotta go through security and you're cursing and yelling at my kids and telling them they're gonna go to jail. And that you're gonna build a jail inside the prison before you fix the gym. I'm not participating in that. And people thought I was crazy. They're like, you work all your life to be a teacher. I said, I don't work all my life for that. I'm out. I'm not participating in that. But then I also understand that we need people to participate in that and stem that tide, right? But really, effectively, the public education school system has been destroyed in this country. We have 3 good years of vitriol against public school education teachers, like they were the reason everything was messed up. And that has been so privatized. You know where that's happened the most is New Orleans, right? New Orleans, after Hurricane Katrina, there is no public education system. It's all charter schools. And their graduation rate has dropped. And they got more juveniles in prison now. So what does kind of society do we live in when 8 and 9 and 10 year olds are already being criminalized, and that mothers and fathers are going to jail for sending their kids to a better school in the next district? Right? But effectively, that system has been so destroyed. And if it hasn't, so many of your schooling experience has been about endless testing and testing and testing and testing, where you actually don't have teachers that are teaching you to think, to deconstruct. You're being taught to take a test. Common Core is the worst thing that ever happened. No Child Left Behind has left more children behind, right? But look, you're also at a time where the Black Lives Matter movement is growing and pushing, where a new generation of Afro-Latinos are not willing to be passive or quiet anymore and pushing back through movements like Not One More. You actually witnessing history in the making. A millennial generation, some older, that was sold a bill of goods under the guise of a lie called post-racial America. Many people believed and hoped that a black man being elected as the president would change your conditions. But I remember something that Chokwe Lumumba, one of our elders in the New African Independence Movement, who became the mayor of Jackson, Mississippi, who died suddenly of a heart attack in office, said. He said to many of us, it's not your condition, but it's always your position. And now, as we look at what's happening contemporarily, right? I call the presidential election the best or the worst reality TV we've ever seen, right? So let's be clear. You have people running on one ticket that have said these things. All undocumented people should be tracked like their FedEx packages. That's Chris Christie. I won't go over the nonsense of Donald Trump, except to say that his nonsense is getting Latinos jumped in the Northeast, where we're like a majority. So there's been hate crimes popping up all over, especially in Massachusetts, where Latinos are just being randomly jumped by white boys who are like, Donald Trump, this is what they're saying when they jump these brothers. And these people are too afraid to report some of them because some of them are undocumented. But there's actually groups in that keeping this information. Or someone like Polly Fiorina, who people like, she's a woman, I'm like, she's like the devil. Mm-hmm. Like, she's insane. Mm-hmm. Or the fact that as women, and even men, that we actually have people trying to defund Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood is the number one place that poor women of color go to get health screenings for breast cancer and cancer screening, where increasingly men of color are going to get their screenings. Less than 7% of what they do is abortions. I personally don't care. You could do 100% abortion. Abortion's a legal right. This is nonsense. You're talking about defunding Planned Parenthood, but you want to give how many trillions of dollars to wars? You want to talk about what you're doing in Syria, but you created ISIS? You want to be mad about domestic terrorism and ISIS? You created an entire generation that hates this America, whatever America represents. And why shouldn't they? You bombed them for 10 years, now you're droning them at weddings. And people think there's going to be no blowback because we live in America? We don't live in a borderless society. They could build 5 million walls. We are a globalized community because of capitalism, because of the North American Free Trade Agreement that Bill Clinton passed. There's no borders for corporations, so why would there be borders for human suffering? There are no borders like that. We have to globalize our thinking at this point. Frantz Fanon also said, one of the things we do is first we recognize then we resist, and then we rebel. I think recognition came as through what we know as the contemporary, or let's say what we know as the civil rights era, right? Which is very different than Black Power. I always tell my students in intro to civil rights class, civil rights was a legislative movement. It was a movement that sought redress under the same justice system. That's very different from Black Power. It's okay that there's a civil rights movement, but there are no more new civil rights movements. The justice system is not gonna fix anything, all right? Like, I think we need to be very clear on that at this point. And not just for Black and Latino folks, poor white folks. They just executed this white man, I think an hour ago in Oklahoma. Refused him a stay of execution, even though the person who did it said, "I did it," and I lied. Right? But the justice system can't ever admit it makes a mistake. So they'll take a life, white, whatever, they don't care, to prove a point. Right? Just like one cop will probably be convicted of murder, so maybe. You gotta have one. It keeps the belief in the system going. Right? But the same system that is shooting us or depriving us of our humanity, how are they gonna give us freedom? But in the 50s and 60s, the civil rights movement was not only necessary, it was the highest level of resistance. Then came Black Power and Brown Power. And now we're in a rebellion phase. I call Ferguson the rebellion phase that we're in right now. Because as I talked about earlier, the system doesn't know what to essentially do with us. It will do these specific things. It will enslave us, imprison us, restrict our movements, impose racial surveillance, institutionalize racism in our institutions, education, politics, economics, entertainment, sexuality, gender. If that doesn't stop us, then they kill us, straight up, our young boys and girls. Ayanna Jones, 7 years old, Tamir Rice, 12 years old, Andy Lopez, 13 years old, Michael Brown, 17, Rakia Boyd, 18, Sandra Bland, Sam Du Bois. We've had 6 more murders, one including in a wheelchair. Brothers in a wheelchair and the cops shoot him dead in the wheelchair. A beating of an 80-year-old man crossing the street in Seattle by a woman of color cop. Right? These are just names I haven't even been able to add. Because honestly, like 3 weeks ago, I was like, I'm done. I can't. It's too much. And part of it is because we have access to media, so we know these stories. But these stories aren't new, right? Like, this has been happening in our communities. What is new is the ability to get the information out, but also how people are responding. How people are responding. If not, they make us political prisoners. I mentioned some of them, but look, our political prisoners are, to me, our warriors. These are people who've been in jail 45 years, some of them, because of their political leanings and what they did during their political, within the political movements. So Oscar Lopez is a Puerto Rican independence freedom fighter. He's been locked up for almost 40 years. He's 72. Jalil's about to turn 70 from the Black Liberation Army. David Gilbert, white anti-imperialist, comes out of the Weather Underground, but then also a more radical white revolutionary group. Mumia Abu-Jamal in Philly, who's probably the kind of most well-known former death row inmate, but also political prisoner. Russell Maroon Schultz, who's been also locked up for over 40 years for his activities in the BLA. Or then I thought of Eric Garner, and I'm like, oh, they just straight up choked us to death in public on the street. Either literally or through what I view economic injustice and gentrification are two of the issues that we really need to be building on. And when that fails to stop us, then they try to build these walls, specifically like in California and Arizona, and I'm like, so you're just building walls on Mexican land, indigenous land that wasn't yours anyway. Okay, and then killing kids on the border. So, as an advisor to, or no, let me not say that, advisor yet, but I would say more as someone who's involved in the Black Lives Matter movement on a national level. Blackness can no longer be regulated to what we would call, well, not a binary, but blackness cannot just be seen as African American in terms of ethnicity and racialization. But I also think that blackness can't just be seen as a phenotype, right? Clarence Thomas is black, but is he really? Phenotypically, of course. But does he really care about us? I don't think so. He was the dissenting voice that wanted to lead the dissent when they eviscerated the Voting Rights Act. The very reason New York became a Supreme Court justice. Right? So how do we think about blackness? We could be black in Ferguson, black in Brazil, in Nigeria, Mexico, Australia, Palestine, or France. But Black Lives Matter is not a really a call to appeal to the system. It's a call to appeal to our own humanity and to step up and to make some sacrifices. Hassan Salam is an MC outside of Jersey. And he did this song with this Afro-Peruvian brother, Immortal Technique. Amazing MC. And Hassan, in one of his songs called Racism is Right on Track and None of It Changes because the president is black. When I went to Ferguson, 10 days after the rebellion had started, people were still on the streets, right? Talib Kweli called me. He's like, Rosa, we gotta get to Ferguson. And I was like, dude, if you're paying, I'm on a plane. Tell me when to be at the airport, because I'm broke. And I'm about to move to LA in a week. But I've got to go down there. I can't be watching this on TV, doing commentary. I don't know where the people are at. And we got to Ferguson with this dope poet, Jessica Camore, out of Detroit. In fact, her and Tyler just dropped a new single, which is amazing. And the minute I got there, I swear, I told people, man, Ferguson brought me back to life. First, I get down there thinking, I want to see the old, usual talking heads. And I did. And Al Sharpton got booed out. They shut Jesse Jackson down. They told the NAACP president, go the F home. I was like, oh, this is great. They were like, F your churches. I was like, whoa, I'm not religious, but that's saying a lot right there. And I was like, oh, this is a turning point right now. From the low of the last 8 years, or let's say 7 years. And what I saw there was, right, Ferguson broke all the rules. First of all, be very clear, people fighting in Terrence and Ferguson were the sets. These were Bloods and Crips, straight up. It was not college students, it was not the priest, the poor preachers were like, please stop. And they're like, get out the way. Like, we're throwing tear gas back at these cats. And when we got there that night, you know, people started kind of noticing who Talib was. And Talib was building with folks. And all you could see was hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of police. And they threw a canister. And one brother was like, and one of the younger sisters and a grandmother, intergenerational. What I noticed, right, that there was not the people on TV, right? Like, was anybody watching Ferguson coverage on CNN with Don Lemon? So it's funny because they weren't even in Ferguson. They were in the mall, surrounded by National Guard doing their reporting. Except that time Don Lemon went out and said he was smelling weed and then got chased out. Like, dude, we're fighting about, you're talking about marijuana. Right? And I got there and I said, this is a huge moment right now. Right? And these young people broke every rule that how you're supposed to be an organizer, how you're supposed to engage your enemy, how you're supposed to be respectable. And one of the brothers is like, respectable? What they're doing to us is inhumane, and you want us to be nice about it. And I said, they want us to march to our deaths and be like, yeah, we're good. Let's just go die. And I said, and the response from the state showed me how afraid the state is when we organize. How afraid the state is when we respond. Minister Farrakhan, in one of his speeches, said, Minister Louis Farrakhan from the Nation of Islam, in one of his speeches, says, America has an objective, and that objective is to deny that black, brown, and red people come together to organize and rebel. Right? And what I realized is that Ferguson was not like just a wake-up call. It was what people have been saying, and it finally manifested in a place nobody expected. The Midwest, St. Louis, Ferguson, a community that's essentially a suburban community, right? And then we see Baltimore. And the thing is that, we're gonna keep seeing these. Because the class contradiction is so high right now, where the majority of our people are living under so much economic poverty, all they have left is their bodies to fight back. And some people in this room will be conservative and be like, they're making us look bad. Well, you know what's making us look bad? White supremacy. Who cares about looking bad or hurting somebody's feelings? Right? But some of us don't care about that. Some of us think if we were nicer. Some of us think if we saw, quote, black on black crime, then we'd be okay. This is the craziest argument. And most murders happen intra-racially. White people kill white people, and black people kill black people. But we don't see the stories of white people every day killing each other, but we certainly see the stories of brothers killing each other every day. We don't see the story of when gang members come together to put a truce together, and then the police go in there to break them up. Or we don't see the fact that when gang members called a truce during Baltimore, the Baltimore police tweeted out that there was beef between the Bloods and the Crips that night. Really, because they were all together unified. But see, the system understands what that means. When brothers and sisters who are in sets, who are in those families, take one moment and turn it around. They take one moment and go, not here, I'm gonna put all the energy over here. And that's what Ferguson to this day represents. As people have left Ferguson, or we call them a good friend of mine, Dr. Jared Ball, calls them the flyover activists have left. Every weekend in Ferguson, they're feeding over 400 kids and giving them books about our people, our stories, our narrative, our experience, our resistance, not just our oppression. I say their names, you need to know who these folks are. Some of them dropped out of college in their second and third year. A couple of them dropped out of nursing school to be in the movement full time. Tef Ho, Tori Russell, Tara Thompson, Rika Taylor, Alexis Templeton, Brittany. I mean, these young people are massively dropping out of school. I'm not trying to drop out of my PhD, but I did put my dissertation on hold for the year. And I told my chair, I said, nah, this moment, I have to be up in it. I can't be right now writing about it and analyzing it. I have a lot of friends that are doing that, and I want them to do that, but I got to be in these streets. I have to see what's going on. I have to bring myself back to life. That's what Ferguson did for me. Black Lives Matter brought me back to life in terms of what the potential of organizing is. So as I wrap up, I think we cannot do something big every day, but I think every day we can do something to expose the system. And as W.E.B. Du Bois taught us, I can strike a hammer to this system every day. I'm gonna call out some names again, you know, and I love that Janelle Monáe and this, well, I'm telling you right now, from Janelle Monae to J. Cole to Vince Staples to Rebel Diaz, old school Talib Kweli, Dead Prez. But the younger cast coming up, Kendrick, see the music they're being forced to make or was in the back is now in the forefront. Because there's too many people saying, none of this anymore. This bling era, all of that is deaded. It's deaded. Got an entire generation of MCs, male and female, coming from, and transgender folks coming from your generation that I thought I wouldn't see. Because the 10 years before has been horrific in hip hop music, in rap music. But one moment turns it around. But to not reduce our lives to these hashtags, we have to call these names. Jesse Hernandez killed, shot 18 times in Denver, Colorado, in a stolen car, apparently. You see the footage, the police shoot her 18 times and drag her body, throw her on the curb. She had already identified as a queer Latina at 17 years old. Andy Lopez, Omar Brego, Ezell Ford, Kajin Powell, Walter Scott, Freddie Gray, Akai Gurley, Eric Garner, Rakia Boyd. These are current names. We have to see this movement as not a hashtag, it's not an Instagram post, it's not a selfie, it's not something that we just tweet. It can't be a trend, it has to be our lives, right? When we say Black Lives Matter, we say it because we must be unapologetic. We have to be unafraid. We have to be unbought. We have to say, I'm not willing to compromise my life and my humanity. I'm not willing to bend. I'm not going to be passive anymore. My daughter, Alicia, is 11 years old, and she's in the Black Lives Matter chapter. She was out in those protests. She saw me get arrested. And yes, she was scared. And when I got out of jail, I told her, there's a target on your back, little girl. I hate to say that to you, but as a Black Puerto Rican little girl that looks phenotypically Black, that gender is not gender conforming, goes as boy or girl, you know, the way she looks, not how she identifies, Afro-Latina with an Afro, Tamir Rice was 12 playing in the park. You have to know right now. And if I don't racially socialize my daughter and tell her the truth, what kind of mother am I? I'm setting her up. But at 11 years old, my daughter can get on a stage and rock within Black Lives Matter as a movement, because it's that intergenerational. And there are children's chapters and children's faces because they kill our children. Either by the straight violence or by economic poverty, by injustice, by not feeding them, by letting children be homeless and not have schools, right? That's what I teach my daughter every day. The rest, to me, I'm lucky. We're all lucky. The fact that we're here today and can be in fellowship, to talk, to debate, to not agree, to have discourse, to not be locked up, I am lucky. I don't see it as a full privilege because I think we all have the privilege and should have the privilege of just being the human beings that we're meant to be, right? So Frederick Douglass says, let me give you a word of the philosophy of reform. The whole history of the progress of human liberty shows that all concessions yet made to her august claims have been born of earnest struggle. The conflict has been exciting, agitating, and for the time being, puts all other turmoils to silence. It must do this or it does nothing. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet depreciate agitation are men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the roar of its many waters. This struggle may be a moral one or it may be a physical one. And it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did and it never will. Find out just what any people will quietly submit to and you have found out the exact measure of injustice and wrong which will be imposed upon them. And this will continue till they are resisted with either words or blows or with both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those whom they oppress. Thank you so much, Winston-Salem State University.